Stay in charge of worship.
Thank you.
again.
Amen.
Are you holding on to God's unchanging?
Yes.
Are you holding on to God's unchanging? As long as we hold on to God's unchanging hand,
yes,
we know everything will be
yes,
all right.
Yes,
let us go and pray. Most holy and righteous Father, we thank you.
Amen.
For allowing us to come out to the house of worship one more time. We thank you, O God.
Thank you.
For your angels that woke us up early this morning.
Amen.
Let us see this day.
Yes.
We come, O God, with thanksgiving in our hearts.
Yes.
We come thanking you for so many things that you already have done for us.
Yes.
Oh, Heavenly Father, yes, ask you to bless our service this morning.
Yes.
In a mighty way.
Yes.
Bless our preacher, Father, as he comes and break the bread of life to us. Oh, for we need the word, oh God. So much going on in this world, Heavenly Father. There's killing everywhere. People are being murdered everywhere, oh God. We ask you right now in the name of Jesus to touch the hearts of those that don't know you. Oh, Heavenly Father, you brought us from a long way. Oh, you brought us, oh God, so far that we can't just continue to just give you the praise. We got to give you the praise because you brought us from the rocking island cradle until this appointed time right now. Oh, Heavenly Father, bless each member here this morning. Bless us all one by one. Bless the ones that are here and the ones that are not here. Oh, Heavenly Father, bless the ones that are sick and disabled. Let them know right now your angels have healing power. Teach us to call upon you, Heavenly Father, when the sun is shining. But when the dark clouds are rising, we can still call on you. Oh, Heavenly Father, right in the name of Jesus, bless our musicians as she played the music for us, oh dear God. Bless each auxiliary of our church. Help us, oh God, to realize that time is winding up. Through our suffering, through our crying, through our waking all night long. It's going to be over after a while. Oh, Heavenly Father, when we get there where you are, no more sickness, no more dying, no more discouraging, no more.
No more.
No more sorrow. Thank you, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Allow us to see that city where we can see our loved ones that are already gone on. And when we all get there, to sit at your feet and be blessed. We shout troubles over, say, we made it. We made it. We made it. Where the sun will never go down. We made it. Where the dark clouds won't rise. We made it. Where there be no sadness. We made it. Die no more. In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name.
In every heart said amen.
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 Thank you. Easter by Sister Vanessa Reed.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The scripture for this morning will come from Philippians, the 4th chapter, the 4th through the 8th verse. Philippians 4, the 4th through the 8th verse. And it reads thusly, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication. With thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and mind through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The word of God for the people of God. Amen. May we all stand for the purpose of the death law from all that dwell. You shall have no other gods before me. Thank you. stuff's been ground.
Jesus is alive. I want to ask each kid, but I want every adult, every adult young, to ask themselves the same thing. And that is, what kind of giver are you? All right, in the Bible, in Acts the 20th and verse 35, Jesus said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. 2 Corinthians 9, 7 says, every man according to his purpose in his heart. So let him give, not grudgingly or necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver.
Yeah, I hate you.
Now I'm going to ask each one of you, what kind of giver are you? Nothing else comes from this. Know that when you give, and if you say, I wish I hadn't gave a nothing, or you go back and after you done gave it, I should have kept my money. Yeah, and those are the things God don't want. If you give it from your heart. And if Brother Sacco told me one time, he said, if you let somebody have something, if they asked you, let me borrow it. He said, don't let them have it if you can't get it to them. He said, because if you expect for it to come back and it don't, it creates problems. So he said, always give from your heart, knowing that it might come back, it might not come back. But God tell you that I love a cheerful giver. And when he loves a cheerful giver, his blessings are in your giving. So if you give your time, give all your time.
That's right.
If you give a prayer to somebody, pray from your heart. Let giving from each one, every person here at Grace Chapel, let giving be something that we strive to do at all times. If it's nothing but just give a smile. Give it from your heart. Because God loves a cheerful giver. Thank you.
Pray for each other, pray for our sick and shut-ins, pray for our bereaved families, pray for our youth. And as the pastor comes today, put him behind the cross and Jesus out in front so that he can give us the message that we need to hear. And as we leave today, I'm asking for traveling grace for all of us. Please come.
Amen.
Thank you.
Father in heaven. Our Father in heaven. For those that did not hear, I said, our Father in heaven. Hallowed be your holy name. A God who's over everything. Thank you. First of all and foremost, I want to say thank you for my early rise this morning. Thank you for bringing us to another week.
Thank you.
Thank you for all the things that you did for us this week. Yes. And you brought us to this point so we can just come in your house of worship and say, thank you, our Heavenly Father, to praise your holy name. To praise your holy name. Hallelujah to your name. Our Heavenly Father, today our hearts are all over the place. This world is in such a bad shape. Children and kids dying, mothers dying, fathers dying, all kinds of violence. But you said in your word that in the last days, this will be a part of our lives. We have sickness. We have some cures and some we don't have cures for. We have life and death each and every day. Our members of this church, we ask prayers and we say prayers for the members of this church who are ill. For Sister Tilly. We call on you because we know. We know that you are healed. We know that you are healed. We ask that you would touch her. Touch her in a way that you can restore her. Restore all of us because we all need you. We all are sick in some way. Thank you, our Heavenly Father. Cleanse up. We come here today for you to cleanse up. Open up our hearts. So when we pray to you, it's a prayer of sincerity. When we ask for healing, God, we ask for healing because we know that you are God and God all by yourself. And there's nothing that you can't do.
Hallelujah.
You've done us. You've done that so many times over and over. You've healed. You've provided. You've brought people to you. You said all of us got to come to you. God, you can open up closed doors. You can remove sickness from anybody. God, we pray for the sick and the sick. We pray for the incarcerated. We pray for Grace Chapel. We pray for each and every member here. Knowing that we have to survive, but we survive only through you. Thank you, our Heavenly Father, for being a God. A God of provision. A God that knows how to say yes, knows how to say no. And know that there is a will for each and every one of us. And your will be done. So God, we ask, if you got us in the palm of your hand, for you to cradle us. If there's healing that we need, God, we ask if you'll heal us. If there's provision that we need, we ask if you'll be a provider. We ask if you'll restore people that we love, their health. Knowing, God, that you can do either. You are Alpha and Omega. You are the first and the last. We give you all the praise. We thank you for everything that you do in our lives. We thank you for giving us a place to come and worship you. We thank you for the leaders of this church. We thank you for the pastor of this church. Bless Reverend Hill. Bless Sister Hill. Bless Reverend Stembridge. Bless his wife. Bless each and every member here. God, we don't know what each one of us need, but we know we are in need of something. You know it all, God. All we got to do is just fall down on our knees and say, help me, God. Help me to change. Help me to make my life better, but only through your will. God, we say this prayer. In your Son, Jesus Christ's name, we continue to pray. We fall down on our knees. We give you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor, because you are so worthy to be praised. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
At this time, we will have a selection by the choir. And after the selection, we will hear from our very own Reverend Charlie Frank Stembridge singing.
Hallelujah. All the stuff we go through. God save us, I believe.
Yes, sir.
We can save, we are free. How many of you feel good when you know you're free? Don't no shackle and burden in the Holy Ghost. You ought to give God some praise. Thank you, Brother Paul, for that teaching of our children this morning.
Amen.
If I can add to that today, I say this is a duck teaching as well. When you, if you don't give and take it back, then don't give. It hurts when you give and somebody I want it back. I thought you just gave it to me.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Brother Paul, for that teaching this morning. Preach time now. I didn't already gave you the clue that only standing up long today.
Yeah.
Yeah. Tired.
Yes, sir,
but God is able.
Yes,
preach, preach.
If you help me, I go, but if you don't, then I stop.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Brother Lee, for being in the house.
Yeah.
Preach time, down the spirit is good and high.
Yes, sir.
I want to dedicate this sermon today to one of my oldest members in the church, Sister Gunn.
Amen.
My dad saw her Thursday. She was lying there by herself, so me and the Lord had a good time.
Amen.
She didn't sit in the back, but we talked and we prayed.
Amen.
And she was kind of wiggling Sister Brown like she was in a little pain, but I know God's going to take care.
Amen.
Amen. But Carl, I took a little oil with me. While she was tossing and churning, I put her on the forehead and she stopped.
Amen. Come on, man.
So today I know God is good. So I dedicate this son to her because with the prayer and the oil.
Amen.
And she settled down and she stopped twisting.
Come on, man.
So you had your Bible today. Book of Matthew, the 25th chapter. You'll find our message.
Come on, man.
Dedicated to Sister Gunn and all of you, the 25th chapter of Matthew.
All right.
25th chapter, begin at verse number 1.
All right.
Amen.
Book of Matthew, the 25th chapter, verse 1 through 4, you'll find our message.
Come on, sir.
Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened to 10 virgins.
Amen. Right, man.
Which took their lamps.
Alright, alright.
And went forth to meet the bridegroom.
Bridegroom.
This verse here helped us count.
Yes, sir.
It said there were 10 virgins.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Which took their lamps.
Alright.
And went forward to meet the bridegroom. But the second verse, Brother John Hightower kind of scared me a little bit.
All right.
10 went to meet the bridegroom. But the second verse said 5 of them were wise. And 5 were foolish. And they that were foolish,
yes, sir,
took the lamp.
Uh-huh.
Brother Charles Green,
sir,
they forgot something.
Yes, sir.
They took their lamp and took no oil with them.
All right.
4 verse, we'll find Brother Roy, our message today. But the wise, took all in their belt. With their lamp. 5 were wise. 5 were foolish. The foolish took their lamp, but no oil.
Come on, break it up.
The wise took all in their vessels with their lamps.
Come on, man.
Want to talk for a little while today keep a little oil in your vessel.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Look at somebody and ask them, say, are you ticking? Keep a little oil in your vessel. I found them today. Found in the book of Matthew, the first part of the 25th chapter.
Come on, preacher.
When you look at the book of Matthew, the 25th chapter, you'll find that Jesus told three parables.
Yes, sir.
According to the writing of the book of Matthew, these were the last three parables that recorded by Matthew.
Amen. Come on now.
We know what a parable is. It's the way that Jesus used a free story to teach his followers. A parable was made so they could see it plainly what Jesus was trying to recall to teach. So we find here in Matthew, the 25th chapter, this was the last three parables that Jesus taught. And when you look at these three parables, they different, but they all have the same meaning. Brother Matt, these three parables, Jesus was trying to tell us, get ourselves right, be ready when he comes again.
Amen.
One of the last things you want to leave it with, don't be like it is in today's world.
Yes.
When you're in the church, make sure at all times you're being ready when he comes. If you look close at all these three parables, it also teaches us you can't get ready after he gets here. You got to be ready when he comes.
Amen.
You know, it's just like in Atlanta when I ride up and down the street, I see the bus route, and all the bus route, you got with a place, the bus stop to tell you what time this bus gonna come.
Amen.
Now, Mark, they pay the bus driver pretty good money. The more time they be almost on schedule. Now, if you know what time that bus gonna come by, this certain stop. If you're ready, standing there, you can get on the bus and keep going.
Yes, sir.
But I want to tell you today, don't think that bus driver gonna come there and you not ready, as Brother Marcus said, gonna wait on you. Sometimes ride it, sad to me, but it might not be the damn that they know what time the bus coming. Then everybody just standing around 10 or 15 minutes, get on the bus and go on about their business. But here you come in the corner hollering and screaming, ain't got your church cleaned up, your pent had pool, said, wait for me. And I want to tell you, going on, it ain't gonna work. Here, Brother Matthew, and see how all of them come up with the same meaning.
Come on, man.
First parable in this 25th chapter talk about the 10 virgins.
All right.
Only thing the 10 virgins is showing us is they had to be ready when the bridegroom came.
Yeah.
He explained to us how they need to get ready, how to be ready whenever time he got there.
Yeah. Right.
Number two parable was he talked about the talent. Use the talent. You be ready to explain to your master what you did while he was gone. You can't wait till he comes and say, now I go to work.
Amen.
You work with Miss Brown and she expects you to be in work and you ain't in work. You say, you're going to go when you come, you might get your pink slip. Then number three was to talk about the sheep and the goat. Only thing about the sheep and the goat was he tried to say, have you done what God had told you to do? You can't wait till you come back and say, I'm going to work.
Amen.
You got to work while he gone. But today we want to talk about the first parable called about the 10 virgins. Jesus told this parable here trying to teach us something. He used the 10 virgins here to try to get them ready to be ready when the bridegroom would come. But one thing about it, they know what time he's supposed to come, but it might not always come on that time.
Yes.
Right. Even though it might be a little bit late, you still, right here, need to be ready when it comes.
Yes.
But Jesus flagged us and told us the good news and the bad news.
Yes. Yes.
The good news and the bad news was, but Vanessa said, there were 10 virgins. Getting ready to go out and meet the bridegroom. But before Jesus went any further, he broke it down. He said, 5 were wise and 5 were foolish. Then he said, all of them didn't get a chance. They had a chance, but they wasn't ready when the bridegroom came. He said, the 5 that were foolish, something here wasn't quite ready. Reason why they wasn't ready, because he said, when they went out to meet him, they took their lamp, but they didn't take no oil in their lamp. So when the bridegroom came, they were left out because they didn't have an oil in their lamp. But I got good news about Greg Chapel. If you wanna be wise, he said, know that wise, when they got ready to go meet Jesus, they took all with their best. And their lamp. Brother William got a car, they had blessed assurance. They had all in the lamp. Then they had all in the belt. If all in the lamp would run out, they had all in the belt, they could hold back in the lamp. But when the bridegroom came, they were ready. So I thought about it, tell you, make sure you keep a little all in your belt. Close at this story here, saying that Jesus was trying to pour it hard to me to tell you that he trying to tell us, he's saying, I am the bridegroom.
Yes.
And those 10 virgins are the church.
Yes.
And not just because you're in the church, y'all, excuse me, but everybody ain't wise.
Yes.
Everybody ain't wise, but most of them, but man, don't want to be wise. If you follow his commandments, you have it made.
Yes,
but you don't follow, you might be left out.
Yes,
but the one that was wise had it made. They had all to put in their lamp.
Yes.
Stop by to tell you, keep a little all in your belt.
Yes.
When I was working, one of my co-workers, a good friend of mine, bought him a house and come out to the job when they brag and said, Rev, I got a pretty good side yard, so I bought me a big riding lawnmower.
Yeah, come on.
All them years, like Brother Walter Reed, he had been cutting your lawn, and one time, end of the season, Miss Brown, he'll put you back in the shed of the tool house and wait for nature to cut again.
Yeah.
After that, one I had went by with Charles, and spring came along, and the grass began to pop up. Somebody hit him on the shoulder and said, bro, it's time to cut your yoke. He went out there and said, and told me, my brother, that he freaked this big ride mower out of the tool house and looked at it, jumped on it. Hit the key and started up, so he was so happy.
Yeah.
Started riding, cutting the grass. Cut about 3 or 4 minutes, made 10 or 12 rounds, and all of a sudden, that big mower just shook and hit brake and stopped.
Yes.
Cut off. He cried and he cried and he tried to start up, but it wouldn't stop. He said he got frustrated. This thing wasn't mighty good, Miss Brown, and all of a sudden, it cut off and I can't start it back. So he went in the house, you know, just got frustrated. While he in the house, he was still twisting and thinking about his lawnmower. Side here, Brother Charles got up and brought in and checked on it again. But this time, on the way walking from the house to the where the lawnmower had and stopped on him, said, something told him, said, you just checked everything else.
All right.
Check it all.
Yeah.
Come on, Pastor, come on.
They got to that mower and flipped that little hood up. Pulled out an oil stick and almost fainted. Didn't have a drop of oil stick. Come to find out, as Brother Green would tell you, engine can't run without oil. But being a friend of mine, he gave me a big smile and a grin and said, Charlie, I said, yes, sir. He said, I can't get mad with nobody, I can't get mad with myself. It was nobody's fault but mine. Yeah. All them years before I started cutting my lawn, all the way before I drank it up and started up, I would pull my stick out, okay, how long it sat down, make sure I got all in the engine. He had to go and buy me another lawnmower. Then he looked at me, my brother, and smiled and told us some wheels of wood that Brother Cypher and Brother Richard Weir would share to us. He said, before you jump on yours now, make sure you take your oil. Other words, keep the oil in your hand. So that's how it is with us every once in a while. Don't just go and go and go and thank you more. Yeah. Every now and then, slow down and stop. Get out by yourself and check your oil.
Yeah.
Check yourself out.
Amen.
See if I'm doing it right.
Yeah.
See if I'm saying it right.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Then you got oil, God to tell you that you're all right.
Yeah.
And our son today, you find that with the bridegroom, the two of the most important words of the word, all invest.
Yes.
Hope y'all got that. All invest. Not the lamp, but all invest.
Yes.
All is a word that got many meanings.
Yes.
You can do a whole lot with all.
Amen. All right.
There are all kinds of all.
Yeah.
Cooking all, basing all, rubbing all kinds of all.
Yes, sir.
But today we want to talk about this old thing called mineral oil, that fuel oil, alcohol, the gasoline oil that go in, kerosene that go in our land.
Yes, sir.
Put the oil in the vest.
Come on, man.
Then the next thing we want to talk about right quick is the word vest.
Vest. Amen.
Vest is the word that has many meanings.
Well.
When you look at a vest, it's a strange that thought of mine of what it is or what it means.
Yeah.
Vessel means that something built or made that you put everything on the inside.
Yeah, yes, sir.
And when you put on the inside, that vessel for the character where it's supposed to go.
Yes, yes.
Some people look at a big ship or a boat as being a vessel.
Uh-huh.
You load it up and it's supposed to carry the cargoes across the water.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Some of them look at the dictionary, look at a vessel that being an airplane, an aircraft. You load it up, you hit a carry cargo through the air.
Yeah.
But sometimes a vessel can be a little small something.
Yeah.
In our body, we got what we call veins. They ain't nothing but a little vessel.
Yeah.
It made it carry our minerals, our blood, other stuff, other part of our body.
Yeah.
But one of the things about a vessel, Sister Green, is that you can't tell what on the inside, because it made to kind of close up and let stuff float down through it.
Yeah.
That's why now and then you can't hardly tell what we have, who we are, because we can't look on the inside.
Yes.
But sometimes you kind of check out the vessel.
Yes.
Now, Reverend Hill or myself or you, go to the doctor, they want to get some blood. They don't pick you anywhere.
Well.
They look for your best.
Yes, sir.
They look for that vein.
Yes.
I know a person that has veins so deep they can't even take blood because way down, I said, well, you did have got veins. There's some like mine and one or two of them that you can just pop out of hand, it pop up and get it, it be gone, but we all have a best.
Yes.
It said in our story here about the oil in the vessel, people are all in the vessel.
Amen.
Look at what it says in our text about the 10 virgins.
Amen.
They went out to meet the bridegroom.
Yes.
But I like verse number 4, Brother Walt. He said, 5 were wise.
Yes, sir.
And look what these wives did. When they got ready to go out and meet him, they took extra oil, but they didn't carry the lamp. They put it in a vessel.
Yes, sir. Yes.
read that they have it, God, because I tell you, if you be an old country guy, if you light a lamp and let it keep burning and burning, what it'll do, it'll soon burn out all over. But these wise virgins knew that everybody had extra oil in their vessel. They know that if it burn out, they had extra oil to put back in the lamp. And I want to tell you today, before I go any further, a lamp without oil won't burn. Y'all hear what I said? A lamp without oil can't shine. You don't mind me saying, and I, by the way, I'll be honest, you seen people like that. They trying to shine without oil. I tell you what it done, it just flicking and a flicking. And ain't nothing light enough. One of the worst things to be is that you're shining and you ain't shining. That's why I love to come ahead and preach at Grave Chapel. I love to think about my men and women down here who God let their light shine. I listen to all of the good stuff down here goes on to the Brown in this church. When I hear Walk Well in Tennessee got sitting there to go in a store and say, how you doing? And let your light shine. Everybody look at him, respect that idea. Brother Paul, with your belly board, how you carry yourself, let your light shine. I don't like to see no half dim or half shining milk. Let your light shine. Let me tell you what lights are about shining. Light is just like a headlight on a car. What there that got that shining pretty car? Headlight make it shine, it got light make it shine two ways. When I get through, I ain't Brother Charles on the right. A headlight make it shine on high beam and low beam. The right, Charles?
Yes, sir.
High beam and low beam. So the green is a town, we put them on high beam. Yes, other times we need to ride them on low beam. Now, if you ride out in the country, where there ain't no lights, when it get dark and real dark, spit dark, then while you're driving, you need to have your beam on high beam. So that thing can shine down the road on the side, you can see where you're going.
Yes, sir.
If you're in the wrong place with the light in the wrong place, it ain't gonna work.
Come on,
ain't no need a car going in the road in the dark with the light on no beam. It might end up hitting a deer standing in the road. You let the light shine in the dark so you can see where you're going. But then when you get to the city,
yes, sir.
Big time social success. Big time Newton County. Then when you get there where they got lights on, you don't need all that light shining so bright. Because you got other little light helping you see what way you're trying to go. Did y'all pick that up? There's going to come a time in your life you're going to be in the dark. If God talking about you and turning the back on you, you in the dark. Sometimes when you can't see your way, you in the dark. Then when you want to put the light on bright. Saying, Lord, when everybody else turn their back on me, here I am, but up there is shining toward you.
Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah.
Then sometimes you can leave them on them.
Well,
I feel pretty good now. Come on. One of the worst things to do is be in the bright light and be in the lights and kind of you want to be bright. Summertime, you don't need all that bright stuff. Especially when you got other light helping you.
Yes, sir.
What did you try to tell me, Stembridge? Well, if you live right. If you treat folk right. If you don't mind helping other folks, it'd be a time they'll help you. Right now you be in a little crowd talking loud when other folk willing to help you. You don't need to be seen for the Lord. Just do what right. These guys here, the wives took best oil in their vessel when they went to meet the bridegroom. Come on
now. Right.
The foolish one got in the hood.
Yeah.
Walk along with the one wise.
Yeah.
Now at home when you do what you hear, some people just can't tell nothing.
Come on.
The wise trying to tell the unwise where the vessel.
Yes, sir.
We don't need no vessel. The bridegroom said you gotta be here at a certain time.
Yeah.
But they didn't have enough to know the bridegroom can sometimes be here. Look.
Yeah.
Sometimes, bad as I want to get down here to graze, I never know what on I-20 and 285.
Yeah.
They get the worst out of it now. You can get in the traffic and you sweat. You can do this, you can do that, but you just can't go nowhere.
Yeah.
They thought they had it made, but when they got there that night, he didn't show up on time and the lamp went out.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Do y'all hear that?
Yeah.
Well, let me walk through this scripture with you right quick, then we'll bring it home.
Hey, come on, preacher.
It started off in verse 1, saying the kingdom of heaven like unto 10 virgins.
Uh-huh. All right.
Took their lamp, went out to meet the bridegroom.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. I got nervous right there.
Yeah.
All of them had lamps and I ain't know who was who.
Yeah. Yeah.
Come on. Come on.
They all look alike.
Hey, man.
Miss Brown, we gotta be careful.
Yeah. Yeah.
Man, I just came out of meeting. I ain't know who was who.
Yeah.
We pulled these preachers, I didn't know who was who.
All right.
They all said we confessed, got our Bible, our stuff, we supposed to be who we are.
Uh-huh. Yes, sir.
These 10 went out to meet the bridegroom.
Come on, preacher.
5 wise and 5 were foolish.
Well,
the foolish took the lamp, but they didn't take no vessel. They didn't have no equal order to go in their lamp.
Come on, yeah, that's right.
One point here, I'll leave you alone in a moment.
Go ahead.
I thought about it.
Well,
everybody ought to have a lamp. Over house and say, hey, you got a gas can I can use that? I don't have one. Man, you need a gas can in your house. You might as well not yourself and need it, but if you don't have it, can't nobody help you because they ain't going to bring it to your car.
Amen.
But it will put some in your can.
Yes.
So these voted for one there, they didn't have nothing but a lamp, but they had sent them to know the order that a lamp could run out.
Yes.
Reverend Hill?
Yes, sir.
That's why I cry to people here.
Yes, sir.
Never know when gonna run out.
Yeah.
I'm gonna be like my tape, might be like the wife.
Oh, yes, sir.
They took all in the vessel with their lamp.
Yeah. Come on, man.
They had some having a while, all of them wanted to meet the bride, but they were just grinning and giggling and having a good time.
Uh-huh.
But the Bible said the bridegroom tells. Somebody held him up. And while they held him up, the Bible said, getting on up in the evening, on up in the night.
Uh-huh.
The 5 wise and the 5 foolish had their lamp still burning, brother Matty, waiting on the bridegroom.
Yeah, yeah.
Kept waiting, and they were waiting.
Wait.
Sometimes you wait, and you wait, and you wait.
Yeah, right.
And then like, the people still won't show up.
Yeah.
This Brown got this big, beautiful dinner, and like to mean nobody want to show up.
Uh-huh.
She just waiting and waiting.
Oh.
They kept waiting so long until their lamp was burning, but the Bible said it fell asleep.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Let
me tell you something now. One point, I got to let you go.
Time.
Anytime you go to bed.
All right.
Make sure.
Yeah.
You ain't a big enough hurry not to say your prayer. Because when we are asleep,
yes, sir.
We healthily, we like dead folk mind up where we are. Don't know what going on.
Yes, sir.
While they were sleeping, Brother Matthew, all of a sudden the next verse said, they heard a voice about midnight. Cried out, behold, the bridegroom coming. All of a sudden, the foolish and the wise jumped up.
Jumped up.
Right.
Thought clicking, start flitching, start clicking, start flitching their lamp.
Yes.
Every time the wise the old fool would click, the light one come on. They get nervous, they're the bridegroom and got clothes. What happened then, bro? Call, they cried to the wise. Give us some y'all. All the time that the wise been helping the foolish. This time, bro, Madden said, we don't have enough for us, all of you all. We just have enough for ourselves. Y'all gotta go and buy some and come back then, he'll be ready. When the foolish one went running with the lamp trying to find some oil. The bridegroom came and they went on in the house. And when the foolish one came back, the door was closed and they couldn't get in. I'm about to tell you, every once in a while, keep a little heart in your lap. You never know when God gonna come. I told to the gun the other day, don't worry, everything will be all right. You better have a little heart in your lap. I want you to have a little heart in your breath. Walking up and down, oh, that's the road. Nobody tried to help the old lady. Well, man, she just walked 2 or 3 miles to town. When you come back, you have a cup and a hand. One on home, one something after another. Every time she go home, she had all in a cup. She would take the all and put it in a drum. And if they tried to go to town, she would take that thing in the cup. You fill up, go home and put all in the drum. But when the water and the weather got bad, they got out of cold in town. Everybody got freezing in town. Everybody didn't have no oil. Somebody thought about the old lady would live way out in the country. They go out and check on our tent. See if she didn't froze to death. But when they got there to her house, they knocked on the door. They never knew nobody was gonna come to the door. They knocked again on the door. They thought she had froze to death. Knocked the third time on the door. One for the Father, one for the Son, and one for the Holy Ghost. Old lady came coming down to the door. Coming down with a smile on her face. Coming down in a hot coat to the door. They opened the door to the old lady when you walk around smiling. Walk around with a hot coat on. Everybody cold out here. Everybody freezing to death. I heard old lady telling me words. Why y'all were laughing at me? Why y'all were criticizing me? I'm putting a little heart in the drum. See, I got heart in my vessel. It's me and my good in my house. I'm not.
get you on the borrowed throne.
Just a few questions. You
you've been around here, so the questions will be easy to ask, easy to answer. Dearly beloved, you are now seeking the great privilege of the union with Christ, which our Savior had purchased with his own blood. Oh, what a price. To rejoice in the grace of God given to you, in that he had called you to be his father. You have heard how blessed are the privilege, how solemn are the duties of members in Christ Church. And wherefore, you are fully admitted, it is proper that you should do perfectly renew your Bible, confess your faith, declare your privilege to answer a few of these following questions. Do you hear in the presence of God in the congregation, renew the solemn promise contained in the baptism covenant, ratifying and confirming the same in honor of yourself, vow faithful to observe and keep the covenant and all things contained there within you. I do. Amen. As you say with faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, you can ask, I will. Do you profess friendly feeling toward all members of this church? I know you do. I do. Amen. Miss Brown, you already been baptized. I've been baptized, and you said, well, you're going to fellowship with me.
To Mr. Gorley, we are happy today on behalf of the steward board, the trustees, and members of Grace Chapel. We officially welcome you to the folds of this church. And as the pastor has told you, you have all the rights that any of us have.
Yes.
We welcome your entire family and to the household of faith. And we hope that your dwelling here will strengthen your spiritual and your holy lifestyle. Thank you, and we bless you. And God will too.
Amen.
Like Brother Sipo said, enough has been said. Now we thank you, Brother, for choosing Grace Chapel to be your savior place. So when it's all over said and done, you know, we just thank you and your family for choosing Grace Chapel to be among us. And like you said, you have all the rights there, all of us have. But thank you for being a part of it.
Let me put comfort in this past couple year. I had a kind of small vision and a dream. I said, we got to build up our youth. We got to get our church bus back on the road. And we need somebody. God, he ain't gave me the wrong person yet to do a job I appointed him to do. So I talked with Brother Gully, he said he would do it. I said, well, you join or don't join, will you do it? But he said, you feel better if I join and you come forward. You have all the rights for everybody else. If you had came out of the street and joined, I would say, we'll wait a few while for you to do this, that, we don't have to do it. You've been here a long, lot of them been here a long time. So you do it for our church, you feel right at home, and you ain't a stranger, nobody, you use a great personality to do a job. Just say, we'll call you here too, because I want you to work too. You don't mind, I want y'all to do my bus ministry so y'all can work together. If you want to ride, he can show you, so y'all will get together and do that. You already got a portal bus load now. Just get about four or five more, we'll be on the way. Right, Brother Matthew? Amen. So I say that's good. I like that, people. I see you make that. You got to have some cheer, so I want all of them to get together because we're working on the choir and all that. That's why I used to build it back up. You give me a great story. Thank you so much for coming, being a part of this church, and giving life to the Lord, starting anew right here with us. Then beside our sister, Miss Brown, and her daughter, all our daughters, good to be a young lady. Now we're so proud of her when y'all are working together as a team. God bless.
Amen. Just want to say amen, young man. God continue to bless you and your family. Amen. Because we are all family here. I join him. We are all family. And this is a good Christian family. And the love of God is right with us all together to carry God's project where it needs to be carried. Amen. Amen.
Born of the Virgin Mary, suffered on the cross.
Stop Solomon.
You want to go out?
Until we all meet again, and everybody said,